Children served, there are 8 for Monee and 5 for Front Forest, 16 one from University Park for a total of 74. And our backpacks are always put to good use when we are doing those. We got a communication from Rob Galley saying that there's going to be Friday, tomorrow, from 6:30 to 9 p.m. at Chicago South Loop Hotel. Join your fellow colleagues of this year, a casual conversation, but it's not happening in Washington. Something came in from Brian Smith, the TOI Executive Director. Basically, it's the township legislative survey, and that if you want to send something back to them, please do it by October 17th. The parade, that was the Moni Hall Fair. Debbie and Bobby and I were in the parade and threw out medical candy and had a good time. Did we make the paper on that? No, I didn't do that. SSA, which is the South River Airport, is having a meeting on Tuesday, September 23rd at 9 a.m. at the Tinley Park Convention Center. Did I sign up for this call? Alrighty, and then one last thing is that we did get a thank you card from Bobby, expressing thank you for prayers and father's thoughts and support during the most difficult time of my life as a result of the passing of my father, ADA, and kindness is greatly appreciated. Thank you, Bobby. Okay. There is a senior May Halloween party. Friday, October 31st, right here in the Moni Township offices. Some of the seniors really dress up. It's really fun. So, and it's UPTV, our senior committee, all seniors that live in Moni Township are welcome to attend our senior events as long as they are 65 and over and live in Moni Township. But they do have to sign up and pre-register. So, we have only a certain number that we can fit in here. So, I think the number is about 100, is that right? Mm-hmm. So, we only get the first 100 that call. All right. Clerk's report.
Well, I follow the 14th annual planning report for the clerk's office on September 10th. Okay. And the process of publishing.
Anything else? Okay. Well, the highway commissioner is not here tonight, so she left a report. And he says, all contracted paving and patching has been completed. Salt bid has been received for $137 a ton as compared to $51 a ton last year. Price of salt is tremendously gone. We are continuing to mow roads, weather permitting. The new truck has arrived and the equipment, snow plow, weed plow, box, and hoist is being installed and should be ready by mid-October. $137 a ton compared to $51 last year.
Yeah, because the estimate is only
$2.37. It's just maddening because they just had a problem with the salt. Okay, special report. We have soccer here. Ken,
I'm here basically in response to a letter that was being from the supervisor with that information on the show.
And the best written by me on behalf of the board.
Tonight. First, I would like So he used a comparison between a giraffe and a turtle. He said, these are two animals by nature, how they're made, most definitely have different perspectives. And the giraffe is built tall and looks high in the sky, but the turtle is built low and has a ground level perspective. Each of them gain their own nourishment from where they are in the scheme of things, but they also have a way that they see the world based on that perspective. So having different perspectives doesn't make it wrong for either of them, but recognition that there are differences in perspectives, it helps. There's no reason to discount one perspective over the other. But sometimes I think we do tend, as humans or people, to maybe when we have a different, let's say, giraffe perspective and turtle perspective, that we do forget that it's okay to have differences in perspective. So my point tonight is, as elected officials, we have different groups. For the township, we've got a group of elected officials that are board members who legislate, and another group who make their functions, like performing the assessments and the highway commissioner, and they don't legislate. But our functions are different, our responsibilities are different, and our consequences are different if the job is done well or not. Once we accept the differences in our functions and perspectives, then it can make collaboration, I think is what I'm really hoping that we can get possible instead of butting heads and disagreeing often as we do sometimes. As an elected assessor for this township, there comes an enormous set of responsibilities that require having a staff, individuals to assist their performing their duties and responsibilities, even more than highway commissioner in that, and I'm just saying it's only because highway commissioner in this township doesn't have an office that he has to manage and run. Before you can even run the assessor, run for the assessor position, you must have a certification as an assessment officer, and that entails taking multiple courses of at least 60 hours or more to be able to qualify to run. But then once you're elected, you then have to serve those responsibilities 24 hours a day. All elected officials that I know do not have standard office hours. Board members do not have standard office hours, clerk doesn't have standard office hours, highway commissioner, and nor does the assessor. So when we talk about having the assessor being paid part-time and the highway commissioner paid full-time, basically that is being placed on when their office hours are for their staff. And I don't feel that that is a good area to measure the value of what the assessor does or what the highway commissioner does. Not their office hours, not their employee's office hours. That's my point. Of course, you have to be kind of familiar with each. I know I know all what David does. He probably don't know what all I do. You all don't know what all I do. But when we talk about perspectives, I think I probably have the best perspective of what the assessor's office and responsibilities are. And all I ask is that you listen to my perspective. Okay. So I have expressed many responsibilities that are occasioned to this board about how things, the responsibilities that have been growing in that office. In fact, it has quadrupled since there has been a raise in this position. Keep in mind, when there were no changes occurring in the office, no market changes like a database being added, automated systems, computer network, assessor website, and not a staff of five or more people, when Jim Harris was the assessor, there were regular increases for the office. Even though those things stayed the same pretty much. In fact, if you look at I did include something for the supporting that the assessor is required to do 60 hours of coursework to be that's A. When I look at D, for included the information that was provided by the supervisor in 2012 when the salaries were reviewed, and you can see that one period between 1993-1996, there was about a 50% increase in the assessor's salary.
it stopped after a while, and I don't know, you know, really the reason why, but I know what has been said is that it's because of office hours and because of the lower VAD is the reason why there has not been increased in less than maybe since 2012, but that's when I was here to hear it. And I don't, I feel that that is not what is supposed to value and measure the value of the assessor's task. So I just ask that maybe you would look at it from another perspective, what the responsibility is, and not take those as reasons for not increasing. I hope that this is not an indication of being, you know, female or whatever in this office. I don't necessarily think so, but I can say this, it traditionally, all over the country, receive females are paid less than their male counterpart, and that is something that these numbers kind of indicate that is happening currently in this township. But I did provide in the C, the item called C, where it's a listing of the Illinois Department of Employment Security wage data from 2012, and is a wage scale for occupation, including appraisal in a separate area there. It's called Code 13-20-21. And there you see from the medium annual wage of about $47,000 to the high of $65,000, thereabouts. And then when you look at further down on that page where they talk about highway maintenance, of course the supervisor, but highway commission rather, but highway maintenance, you see a code 47-40-51, where the median is about $49,000 and the high is about $59,000. I can say the assessor's salary is nowhere close to even the median, but I did notice that, you know, they are currently being paid, I think, around where it should be, you know, close to the high. So what is not equitable, I feel, is that the median ranges to the high range, both in the Department of Employment, is around 6 to 9% difference between the two. But when you see what the actual salary is for the assessor versus the highway commission, it's about 30% difference. So that's what I'm saying. Now I feel I'm earning 70% of what the highway commission is earning, and I don't feel that it's being addressed properly.
Well, let me just point that out. He has a 40-hour job. Yours is less than 20 hours per week. His is 40 hours per week, which is why he's getting what you're paying, and you're getting paid less than 50% less than he is. I mean, you're $32,000 a year. He is $54,000 a year. So you are even paid more than half of what he's making.
Well, because that's what I'm saying. The wrong reason is poor because you have been using that as your reason because of the office hours of my staff.
And we will continue to come
not the office hours or the responsibility that I have. That's what I'm saying. It should be the responsibility.
I've said in the past, Sandra, that if you will look at the, I as a supervisor and the CEO of the township, I have vast responsibilities.
Mm-hmm.
I pay $10,000 a year. Now, I don't keep regular office hours, but I'm here on a pretty regular basis. And also, I have a lot of authority, and I'm doing the compliance check. I mean, there's a lot that I do.
Okay.
I don't know what I do either, right? Okay. But since 2000, my salary's been $10,000. 2000, 2004, 2000, we've not raised the salary. And we don't base salaries on what we do, because you have to realize that as being an elected board, it's not here to make money. An elected board has always been one of these quasi things that, yeah, it's really nice that we get a salary. It doesn't mean that we're going to be paid for what we do. We have to consider that the rest of what we're not being paid for is basically what we are contributing back to society. When you ran for the office, you knew what the salary was, okay?
Nice.
And so my thing is this, I'm assuming that you ran because you wanted to be assessor and you wanted to be helpful, but that you also realized that part of this is a surface job. This is a township, it's not a corporate. You can't compare it with wages in the corporate sector at all. before the next board takes effect, which is in 2017.
That's when you decide, it doesn't say you pay the salary.
That's 2016, but we're not, that's when we decide, the only time we can change it. We're not gonna discuss it, I can tell you right now, that if there isn't a raise, because of the amount of money that we have to live with the township, there will not be big raises. If we go up $2,000, that's gonna be a huge amount for us. Our township trustees are only getting like $1,800 a year, and they do a lot of extra stuff on their own time. And, you know, if I put in for an increase of it, it might be $600, but we're not gonna be going up in salary more than $2,000 for anybody. I can tell you that, that's what my recommendation is gonna be for the board, and that's gonna be 2 years from now.
All right, well, like I said, we're not gonna discuss it, but I'm just mentioning because in your letter, many times you said, this is what David is doing, we would like for you to do it, and so I'm saying, but you don't really.
Well, I was told by the board to say that.
Okay, fine.
Maureen Brown was not here tonight. Now, I want to let the public know and the panel know what we were, what your letter referring to, because I'm sure people are confused. I was directed by the board to send a letter about our audit. When our audit came in, there were some, quite a few things. It says, for one thing, it was discovered by the auditor that the assessor's office is paying all part-time people overtime when they, if they work, their normal shift is 20 hours a week, then if they work over that, she pays them overtime for that. State law is that you do not pay overtime, you know, till somebody, you have to pay overtime if somebody works over 40 hours. Okay, that's the state law, and that's what we have always used as a township. And so I just said, the board does not think that you should be paying part-time workers overtime until they reach 40 hours. State law only requires that overtime be paid for all workers, part-time or full-time, once they have worked 40 hours. A highway manager pays overtime only if the staff works over 40 hours. The township has always followed the state law, and that was one thing. The other item that caught the board's attention was the continued use of your personal credit card for office supplies and paying bills like your cell phone. The highway commissioner stated that the cell phones he has for the highway department are billed to him personally, but once he reviews the bill, he turns the entire bill to Willa to be paid with a township check. The board thinks that if you, thinks you, this is what you should be doing also. They also stated that they want to see the entire bill, which we've not been getting on my side, showing all the itemized calls, or, this was the board saying, they will not authorize paying for it. In the future, please submit all bills for services rendered to your office that are billed to you for payment or township with a township check. Also, please order from Quill or some other supply outlet that will bill you so the bill can be paid with a township check. Most of your supplies, even coffee cups, filters, etc., can be purchased through a supply outlet. As always, there might be a few items that you need to purchase yourself and submit the receipt for repayment, but the board is asking you to keep those to a minimum. The auditor also noted that you are not always using the packet bill letter when you are making purchases for your office. Please try to do so in the future. I know that it is not always possible to use this letter, but please try to use it as often as possible. And that was a letter that we sent regarding discrepancies in the audit. There were just too many, and there were a couple other things that was mentioned in there that had to do with they want us to put a meal line in your assessment budget for next time. They wanted us to move a pantry in the social services. There's a whole list of things in the audit that were given as suggestions by the audit that were things that we can easily comply with. But these were just the three main things that the board picked up on and asked me to send you a letter on.
Okay. Well, I got a copy of that audit too, and that's what I was going to ask you. Were you saying that these items were in the audit? I looked through the audit.
Well, they're in the audit of the management letter. They're just part of the audit.
Yes, I read the entire thing, including
all the letter. All this is in there.
And what I did not see is any of this in there.
Well,
if you could just tell me which page, possibly.
It's not a page, it's a, in the letter. The letter, there were two separate letters that were sent to you at the same time. And it's in that. It was the recommendations. And there were, and I don't have, do you have any copies of those?
Okay, because well, I didn't get that. I got the report that it had none of them.
Well, I'm sure that we gave it to everybody.
I didn't give it.
Well, if it wasn't a mistake, because we send those to everybody.
Okay, well, what I got in that, audit, Bob, I thought you had it on your desk there. Yeah. No. The audit report, the one, yeah, that right there, I got that. And if it was a management letter in there, I didn't get it, because I read it twice. And I looked specifically for the items that you listed in the letter to say that these things, that they mentioned, that they're not in there.
There was a bond audit, and then there were two separate letters, and it was all these, our recommendations, everything that comes within the recommend management letter that they give to us. And those were given to all board members, and I don't know if she did put it in there, but it was a mistake, because they were sent there.
Well, I didn't get it, but she.
Oh, the lawyer has it, right here.
I didn't get it.
Now, here it is, it's in the letter dated July 15th, well, the board of trustees, and it says findings on the budget, recommendations, findings, and then it shows the township posted insurance expenses, and then it also said, township posted assessment meals for either office supplies or travel expense accounts, and those are kept to come from your office, because Willa only puts them where, you know, you guys, when you send in your bills, you say what accounts to put them to.
Yeah.
She puts them to those accounts, so that she's saying, they're saying what's that, because they were going to office supplies and travel expenses.
Sometimes it was for training, yeah.
This is a meal.
Yeah.
Now they want a separate, now they want a separate one. But then there was a whole overtime recommendation.
I think I should have gotten it, I didn't get it, I did not get it.
Alright, well, we will definitely have to sign it, because this is what we were basing all of the comments in.
Exactly, and I think I should have gotten it from you.
Well, you should have.
Okay, but I did not agree. Alright, so that was my thing, is where that in the audit, because I didn't see it. So now that I know that you're saying that it was in a management letter, I will read that after the training. But one thing that I did notice in the audit, the copy that I got, was a mention in the section that said unaudited. So I'm assuming that those were words and numbers that were provided by a supervisor. It reads that, the assessor continues to lower property assessment throughout the township with, This means that a lower EAB affects the amount of taxpayer dollars we collect and operate the township with. This is not true. I mean, part is true that the assessment has been going down, but we cover this in our workshop. What we do is let you know that how you get your dollars from your budget is once you submit to the county clerk, how much you need to complete your budget. They figure then what your rate would be to get those dollars. So EAD lowering doesn't keep you from getting what you asked for. It doesn't. And in fact, if you look at in the audit itself, one of the pages I think I did include in the attachment to you, I think I labeled it number D, where you see from 2013 what you got for total taxes from property tax is less than what you got in 2014. Every year you've got an increase. So that statement it's kind of like misleading to say that because the EAB is lowering, that affects the amount of tax dollars that you get to operate the township. That's just not true. Alright, but the next thing, on the first paragraph where you said about overtime, that it should not be paid until 40 hours have been reached. You didn't tell me what law that you were going by, so I just did a little research myself. What I found is, first of all, if we had to work 40 hours a week, then we would be that part-time office that you call us, and therefore we'd be full-time, wouldn't be, you know, the use of saying that the assessor gets paid less than 1,000 hours. But it would also mean my budget has to be doubled, too. So I got to keep that in mind. I don't think nobody wants that. So I have established as an assessor in our group what the office hours are. They're published, they're on our website, so they have been established. What the law says is that first we have to establish what our work week is. I have done that. Then it says, I think I'm at RAD now about number E, attachment E that you have. Once it's established, the work week has to be established by the employer, okay? And then it's allowed to establish what the regular pay will be and The law does not say that you have to work 40 hours to get paid overtime. What it says is that no employer can employ an employee and have them work more than 40 hours without having overtime or at least 1.5 times the
You're misunderstanding. I didn't say that you couldn't pay. The assessor, the auditor basically says that if you are going to do that, you need to set policy. I'm just saying that what the board members have said is that they think it's a waste of taxpayers' dollars that you are paying overtime until under 40 hours. So you should not pay that. And that was our opinion as a board because we're worried that you're spending your taxpayer money and also on your own budget. As I said, your budget, you went over your line and had to transfer money into your salary line last year several times. And now, I couldn't figure out why, because I thought we had figured, now we understand why. It's because you were paying overtime when it wasn't necessary to pay overtime. Now, as you said, we all know you set your salary as assessor, that's up to you. But you also need to be mindful, as this board tries to be mindful, that these are taxpayers' dollars, and that you are misspending taxpayers' dollars.
Wrong word, not misspending. Now, here's the correct thing.
Well, if I'm a taxpayer and I'm a taxpayer, I'm complaining, and every board member.
But that's because you have the wrong perspective. Let me give you the
wrong perspective is that we shouldn't be trying to save the taxpayer dollars.
You can respond to it, but you need to hear what I have to say.
I'm listening.
Listen to my perspective, okay? When we have overtime, it is not just frivolously done. We, especially during this time of the year, we have deadlines that we have to meet. More this year than we've had deadlines because we have more state appeals to be done. When I have to ask my staff to stay over their 22 hours a week, that's standard for them, and I need that done in order to meet this deadline so we can meet the requirements that the county and the state requires, I'm not going to expect them to just say, we'll drop everything without there being extra incentive. And I do have the right to give them extra incentive. And when I establish the work week as what it is, that goes to after that. But now what I did find out when I read the law, it does say, not 40 hours, but at least 8 hours. So I'm amending that, because I think before we were doing it after 7 hours. I'm amending. In my rules, I'm going to get the bottom, this is after 8 hours a day, and that is within the law to do that. But the reason why I'm doing it, and you need to understand, is that I can't do it all by myself. And when we up there sometimes at midnight, I don't think you should expect me to tell them just work for the one pay per hour and, put your life on hold, make these sacrifices, and I don't give them any extra per hour. I feel like that's what I need to do to pay them for what they're doing. And I mean, it's really only one employee that really gets that, to be honest. The rest of them, they have whatever they're doing in school or whatever, they can't do it. So it's really only one, and it's not misspending.
Well, but overspending was my opinion, not misspending, overspending. While you're paying your son overtime, I saw in checks, and I was paying your daughter-in-law overtime on checks. So that's two employees that I'm seeing on a regular basis over time.
Not on a regular basis, not for my son, because he works another job. Not on a regular basis. One person is Rebecca.
Let me ask the board, would anybody else here like this comment? And not just you. This is what said last week.
Sandy, I was here. But that's not the conversation. It was clear. Okay. And it surprises me that if you're not required to do something, why would you do it? Just hear me out. I can understand that if you want to recognize your employees for doing a good job. Okay? But in this day and age, as tight as money is, if state law says you're not required to do it, and they're not putting in 40 hours a week, my concern, in regards to me doing the job as trustee, according to state law, is that I have some concern. Okay, why would we be paying an employee haven't reached the 40-hour minimum. Now, that's the first one. The second thing is that you gave me a copy of your letter, and it's identical to the letter that John wrote, okay? And in my mind, from what I gathered from your notes, you're just disputing the items in paragraph 1 and 2. You have no problem with paragraph 3.
No problem with 3.
No problem with 3.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And just in paragraph 1, you just wanted to know the law.
No, I wanted to know what, first of all, was this coming from the law, because I had not gotten what she said I had.
Yeah,
and then,
you got a copy of the letter, because I distinctly.
I did not got it. No, no.
Wait a minute. I distinctly asked twice last month, if you can review the tape, did Sandra get a copy of this? And the answer I received was yes.
But I didn't hear that answer.
No. All right, but Sandra, okay, let me come and finish. The second thing I said was that make sure she get a copy of it. And I said, okay, fine.
Still didn't get it.
Okay, so given that, okay, I heard what you said. If you knew this letter went out before the board meeting, why didn't you try to get a copy of it?
I didn't know a letter exists other than what was in the audit that I got. I had no idea that a letter exists.
Okay, so
it does now.
Paragraph 1, you had some doubts about. Paragraph 2, you said copies of bills. We asked for copies of the entire bill, not part of the bill. The entire bill. Okay, and I distinctly, it was me, asked David, does he get a cell phone? And he said yes. So when you get it, what happens? After I review it, I give it to him to be paid. All of it. All we asked for is a little cooperation. You get the entire bill. Give us the entire bill so it can be reviewed and the bill paid. It's just a matter of cooperation with me. Okay? And what the board is saying is that unless you do that, in my opinion, we're going to be hesitant about paying that bill. Okay? Now, I do believe this came up before. About a year ago.
Sure did.
Okay, about a year ago. So in my mind, I'm looking for progress, cooperation.
Well, that's my response to your stuff.
Mm-hmm. If I remember correctly, you said you could do it.
If I remember correctly. There is no itemizing this. That's what I told you then.
Okay. All right. So when you get your cell phone bill, you turn it over all.
That's fine. But let me, can we get this? I'm not quite there. You want to skip through this because I was trying to
go through this. I want to stay focused on this letter.
Right, me too. Right. Me too.
Okay, now the only other issue you said is that we asked that you use Quill. And you said you already used it.
I am.
Okay. And there was no mention about the personal use of your credit card.
No.
So how do you feel about that?
I'm going through all of it, but if I don't want to have to bounce around. I was trying to get through it all.
I'm on paragraph 2 now.
Okay, no, not yet.
I'm on paragraph 2 where it talks about the use of your credit card.
Okay.
Okay, now paragraph 3, we have no dispute.
Alright, so as far as using a personal credit card, I do that at a minimum. Last year, in fact, I believe I was the one that came to you all and said, because I think that month I had like $800 reimbursement, and I said, I can't do this no more. And I said then that really, and I started from that point on submitting a lot of the bills for you to pay. A lot of them. Okay? And to where it's like a much smaller amount that I have to pay, period. Because I'm not getting an increase. I don't have the extra money to pay. Using my credit card and having to pay. So I use my credit card as a minimum already.
Well, we were just kind of wondering why, since we'd asked last year that you have, you know, give the bills to us and we pay it with the township check, why you were continuing to use your credit card.
Are you talking about the phone bill now?
For the phone bill.
Okay. I just addressed it in general. So now that the township would provide a car for me to use, I have to continue using my car. Okay.
We're not
going to
provide the car.
Okay, all right.
The board requested a year ago saying, give us the whole bill so that we can pay for the township check, because that keeps coming up, and I think that's the second item in the whole.
So I'm glad that
please
we're
give
at that point now.
We'll pay for it with a township check.
Okay, I'm going to talk about it. Something else to do with that. When we mentioned it last year, I said to everybody that there is no itemized bill that come in. This is the one you see on the top, is what I submit, because it's just for for the township part of the bill. I did say last year that I have coupons, and I said that if what you're looking for is to see if I'm using the township phone for personal, I said then last year I have coupons, and I use my phone for my personal, I use the township phone for the township bill. Now, if you look on page 306, this is the actual bill that I get from Verizon. And page 306, you see the breakdown of charges. And oh, yeah, by the way, on out of six pages, you never see any itemized list of calls. The phone number that I have highlighted is the phone number that is my personal. The other number is the township. Before I actually got a contract, because I remember first I was just going to pay as you go, but I kept Verizon, and then when I went to the contract, they said, you can add another phone for the extra $51.71, is what you see there, that includes taxes. So what you see when I submit my bill is $104 that the township paid out of the bill amount of $160. I gave each one of you all different bills from the year, from last year till now, currently. It ranges anywhere from $160, $159. It changes about less than a dollar per month. And so sometimes I adjust it with $105 or $104. That's what you see from me for the township to pay for my bill. If you like for me to submit the whole bill, then the first thing I want to know is, are you interested in paying the whole bill for both phones, or you just want to see a list of calls which you don't get to see anyway? I mean, I can certainly, as you say, corporation, give you a copy of this and give you a copy of this, which is only the part that you should pay. So I can do that. I have no problem with that.
From my perspective, it's just my perspective, okay? I would prefer if you separate the account, okay?
That's your preference.
Township phone. Township bill.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with the personal account. I would much rather see it. Because that way, it leaves no doubt.
It is no doubt.
It's no doubt.
It is no doubt.
Well, because you're getting a better rate because of the township, so you're making a personal gain, which is something that's not allowed by law.
Okay, all of it is in my name. Okay, so I'm not making a personal gain.
Well, you are because you're getting a better plan for your own phone. I can't even look out if I'm putting it on my personal account, and you know, the just the Dell, I believe we were getting built.
Right, we got a house in Dell.
Right, you know, so now we are getting, you know, so we're paying more bills. But still, the auditor says it's not enough, because they were just noticing that too many supplies were being bought through Ultra and other places rather than.
But they're not using credit card, they're saying not to use the,
They're not saying don't use it, they're saying please watch them and try to use, have things charged as much as possible.
Exactly, you can watch it, they're not.
And paid with the tax.
Right, right. But I, like I said, the third item, I 100% agree, I'm glad y'all made a suggestion to use the township bill. Actually, I've already started doing it, and it works great. Just take me a little bit more time, but I sound a little, another thing to get a tax exempt. But fine, to save the money for the township for not paying tax, I'm good with that. Alright, so the credit card, I am already minimizing the use of that. The cell phone, we still haven't resolved that, is do you want me to submit that?
Can you, so you can get your bill, I know you can print, Sprint, you can print our lot, can you just print it off for this line?
What do you mean?
You can print the detailed part of your phone bill.
That's it?
When I receive my cell phone bill, I get nine lines, I don't look with all the.
Are you with Verizon?
No.
Okay.
But I believe Verizon, they probably could give you a charge.
Say again?
They said this box, if you have more questions about your charges, you can get details for usage.
Yeah, but if you're talking about providing the bill, that's what I'm providing. The entire bill.
And they're asking for itemized cost.
Right.
Which is a standard part of my cell phone bill every time I get a monthly.
Right, but you don't have Verizon. Verizon doesn't do it.
Well, then.
In fact, they're trying not to even send out the bill. They want to refund it.
I'm kind of with James. I think it would be better if you separated accounts, but if you're not going to, then I would say you submit the whole bill and just, you know, strike through, X through what is not to be paid to the township and put the $104 on your.
That's what I mean. And that's what I've been doing without attaching the whole bill. But I'm still going to pay the bill, the whole bill and tax. I always pay the bill before the expense is submitted, if you notice that. I pay the bill first, and then
we're saying, you know,
fine,
somehow we're going to have to separate. See, the problem is we need to pay your cell phone bill with the township check.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you,
you
want
say you
to
need
pay
to
the, if you want to pay $104.03, and then you pay what the balance will still be paid.
Fine, but that's what actually happened.
Well, because we're paying, aren't you paying now the whole $159?
Yeah.
And then we're putting in requests for reimbursement.
Yeah.
And we're saying that we would rather not do it that way. We'd rather that you submit the bill, we'll pay what you say is township, $104, and then you pay yourself the remainder.
Okay, so you want the Verizon to get two payments?
Yep, that's their problem. My problem.
Well, no, you made it my problem.
Well,
that's
why
the line
was going
to
pay.
That makes sense.
You were going to pay a check anyway, but only pay it for your portion. The township will send a township check on your account.
I can tell you this. I don't know if you ever deal with most of these children or whatever. You want to start sending them partial payments, and it don't get applied, it's just going to be open up ahead. Now, if you want me to submit the bill, because I actually paid before. Starting now, and maybe I'll submit like two bills, which I probably need to do anyway, because I didn't submit enough, because I didn't want to hear you saying, we ain't paying, we're going to do this. You will give me the money, you will give me a check for it, and then I'll send my additional check with it, and I'll be paid at the same time. That's fine. But I don't want to have Willis paying par, me paying par, and they say, we didn't get this by the day, and now you owe, I don't need that.
Because the utility bills and things like that are something that we pay as we go. It's not something that has to wait for the monthly board meeting.
Okay.
It's one of the.
Okay, well, good. And how about that?
So once your bill is submitted, we'll have a township check made out for it.
Right.
You can will a little county
I'll
pick
it up.
And then
anyway.
You can pick it up.
I'm good. I'm good with it.
All right.
No problem.
Do you understand what we're doing?
Does everybody understand that? So we'll have to discuss it next year.
That would be good. And that would be
all
right. The auditor would be a lot happier.
That's fine.
We won't see that on our reports.
Okay. All right, and I was asking though, since you said that David reviews his and then he pays the entire bill, do you go through and determine which calls are personal and which ones are not?
He doesn't, he's at all just comes, he doesn't do personal calls on his cell phone calls.
But how do you know though?
He reviews the bill.
Okay.
He has three phones, you know, he has three phones that he uses with his men in the field.
There you go, that's all I'm saying.
And he reviews, he makes sure that everything is correctly charged on it, and then he submits it and we pay for it with a township check out of his account.
Right, and so thank you, you take that, and when David has the local phone, he's not using the one for the township, we're gonna be, that's all I'm asking, that you take that from me.
As far as I know, that was never the accusation that the person told him calls to the township phone.
No, last year it actually was, the letter, the email that I got from Donna, she said the reason why they were asking to itemize bills because I wanna make sure that the township money is not going to pay my personal costs, that's exactly what I'm saying.
I don't think I said that.
I got a copy of the bill.
Well, Dr. Sanders, let me share with you, right now, the concern is not about any personal.
Okay, all right.
It's just access and getting the information.
All right.
To pay the bill.
Okay, and I have a copy of the bill on there.
And other thing we said was because the audit report brought it up, and there were other things that when you get a chance to read the management letter, you'll see that there are other suggestions that were made, and so that you can look at and remove this stuff later.
This is what you had said, man, that's the reason why you asked that last year, see that how to make sure that township is not paying for cause of witness. So that's what I was referring to.
So,
it's availability.
Okay, all right. No problem, I will be attending the bill, so it's like this.
It's not for personal.
That's fine. But you know, like when I read, if you don't do it, are we gonna not pay? And like I said, I wasn't here, that's all I hear is like, you know, it's like kind of like, well, you know, you doing something wrong.
No.
Because there would be no other reason for you to say not that you wouldn't pay it.
Sandra, again, use the analogy of people's perception.
Perspective.
Okay. Now, in my mind, well, I use the word perception because of the way I think it is.
Okay.
And for me, it's business.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's just a matter of cooperation. And I guess what baffles me about this whole issue is that it's a constant argument about taking care of business. Now, from my perspective, if I'm being held accountable for taking care of some business, I want to do it in such a way where there's no room for controversy, and there's no room for continual argument. That's my perception of taking care of business. And all we ask for, the only thing I want, is the same thing I reiterated to you last year when we had the auditor's report. I said, Sandra, can we
You're not.
Because you told me last year you would stop using the person's charge card.
All right,
well, I'm asking you again this year.
And I'm saying, as the supervisor said, there's going to be times when I need to use it. I'm not going to receive it. You asked me never to use it. I'm not going to receive that.
Well, can we agree that
keep
we'll
that
be much?
Yeah, keep that in mind. That's to my benefit.
Okay, to the extent that the auditor won't raise the red flag.
Yes, I agree. And then when you're getting the bill and you're paying that, that's one part. That's the biggest part right now. To be honest with you, if Donna and Donna knows, that's the biggest part of being reversed in the bill. Okay? So that won't be a no issue. Alright, so where we go. Yes, right now I am using Quill. We use it for most of our big purchases. There's still times when I'm out and I see a good deal, I'm gonna get it for the office. I'm still using my credit card, things like that. And then pretty much the tax exempt letter, I'm making the purchases. And right now, and it is an excellent idea, thank you all for bringing that up. I hope that we don't have to come back to this again next year, because this is the same conversation we had last year. So I don't know.
The only reason I was brought up again was because of the auditor's report. And as I said, you've got a little more time, you can review it all the time. I'm sorry that you didn't get them, but they were, you know, we thought they were sent with everybody, but they apparently.
Oftentimes I don't get everything to draw me. I don't know why, but oftentimes I don't. Maybe it's because they don't think it's pertinent to me. I don't know. But again, about the overtime, we're coming up to our busy season. We're going to have some overtime. Mostly it's going to be Rebecca that you're going to see that. But I will, and I have changed my policies, or I have added an addition to policy that says only has to exceed 8 hours per day. There's only 2 days a week where we work close to that. So that'd be good.
Is there gonna be under 40 hours a week?
It's gonna be under 40 hours a week. It's gonna be under 40. If
but it will help her and will help the taxpayers because she's now saying that she will not pay unless somebody works actually 8 hours a day. If they work 9 hours a day, then that last hour will be paid overtime. And if that's her policy, she doesn't have the right to make that policy. I'm not the servicer, I agree with it, but it will be better because if they normally only work 4 hours a day and they work 8, they were getting paid 4 hours a day.
No, they weren't. That was never the case. It was always over 7. It was never over 4 hours. This was never that.
So if I understand this correctly, the assessor's policy supersedes their own.
Says an employer can't pay in excess of the minimums. I mean, if an employer wants to pay $200 an hour, they can pay $200 an hour. The law says this. If you're going to employ somebody for a 40-hour work week or in excess of a 40-hour work week, then for those extra hours,
But what I'm saying is that if you have an employee that's working less than 40 hours a week,
all of them are.
Okay. And state law says that you're not required to pay overtime anything not exceeding 40 hours a week.
Now it's going to be 8, maybe 10 hours that they report for work without not paying them extra for those extra hours over eight. And that's what I've been doing. It has not been on those days when it's 4 hours. It was never that. And so, and because I need them to stay, I have a deadline that's got to be met. I have to be compliant with the county and the state to get this document to them. I have to have it. And I think it's not being overspending, it's not wasteful spending. It's taking the situation as it is that I need their extra time and I can ask them to do it and pay them extra. That's it.
Well, then will we agree to disagree, I guess, on that point, because...
Well, I'm just going to point to him on number F. It says that extra compensation, you see the one that says F.
I read that, and okay. I did mention, I reviewed the tape last board meeting. You know, I mentioned that the auditor did leave room for you to...
Okay, yeah, I have to read it.
Okay, I just find the whole process that you explained to the excessive spending.
Yeah, but that's what you're expecting, but you don't have, you're not responsible for doing that for the job, you're just not. You can see from the outside, you can say from the outside that's the way it appears.
You know what I would do?
But you're not having responsibility.
You know what I would do? If I needed that employee for 10 hours, and they only giving me 20 hours a week, probably give them a day off. Okay? I'll probably tell them, you don't have to come in tomorrow, even though your schedule says that. Come in Friday.
But if we got, if we got a deadline, hold on, but if we got a deadline, and I still need that key person, I can even afford to give them a day off now.
So you can give them some time to stay in a non-busy time.
Exactly. Exactly. I can happily do that every day. So that is an option. Yes, absolutely.
Okay, well, let's move on to the attorney's report. Anything, Gerald?
Nothing to report.
Committee report. All right, new business. Just a reminder to the trustees that the QIN conference is November 9th to 11th. There is a deadline we have to apply for, so we'll need to know by October 1st if we're planning on going or not, because we have to sign up and get rooms and pay fees and that type of a thing. All right, also, just announcing the deadline for the October newsletter is October 17th. So keep that in mind also. Now the old business, the Wheelwright program, we've got a report that was that our visit for June, we're always a couple months behind, and our report for June is that we owe $4,875.42, which is half of the cost, because half of those, it was, the total was $9,750.84 for Moody Township. We have 50% local grant money, so our portion is just half of that, $4,875.42. I need a motion to approve paying the June bill. Okay. Anybody there? Okay. Anybody care? Any discussion? See none? Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Rowe?
Yes.
Trustee Barry?
Yes.
Trustee Young?
Yes.
Yes. I got a note from Maurice telling me that the claims, Illinois Claims Track Team, which we were talking about social service agreements, were not going to be here tonight because they're still working on getting additional information. What we found out when they came last time, that what we needed to get was a current not-for-profit status letter. Is that correct?
Right.
If
you had checked, the family had been...
small groups, and yearly, according to Illinois, they're supposed to put in for a new status every year. Some groups don't do it, and this group didn't know they had to do that, so they now have to get their not-for-profit status letter in order, and so we will just wait and put this on next month's agenda. And could be brought back again. Project reports. Our youth committee, Maurice is gone, but he did also send a note. And where is that? Anyway, basically, he sent an email to the guy at GSU back and said, no, we still haven't set our schedules yet. We haven't set our schedule.
This is table 10, volleyball.
First he asked, he said, do you have any dates for the board meetings this week? And he says, Maurice, we're still in the process of developing our basketball, volleyball, and table tennis game and practice schedule. I'm notifying you once we have completed this process. So unfortunately, at this point, we are kind of a stalemate with our new program. What I would like to do, and Jane, you're very active in this, and here, is I'm thinking that what we should do is send a letter to all the families that were signed up last year, just saying we're very sorry, but at this point in time, we are still waiting for GSU to make the commitment, and that we will notify you as soon as we find out if and when our program will start again.
There is some interest, and
recommendation is that we tie it into literacy, okay? In terms of, and there will be some involvement by the parents in terms of developing the contract with the kids. So, again, I'm still in the planning stages. I'm trying to keep it alive and keep it within the geographical boundaries of this township. But it's going to take some additional work. So if you're interested, you can come out on November 18th, 7:30, at University Park Public Library, and see the PowerPoint presentation on it. Or you can take a look at it on the website. All you got to do is Google NEMPA, which is National Youth Project Using Motorbikes. And that's where we are right now. That's where I am right now. Still working on it. So
it's a work in process.
Right.
And going green is also an process thing.
Yeah, also, there's one thing. The program would not be implemented until the spring anyway. So we're still on target. But all the ingredients of how we want to operate needs to be in place. So I'm still making progress.
Now, I was talking, the program that was in existence at Thornton had to do with working with the police department and getting a list of troubled teens, I believe. Wasn't that their basis originally?
No, it was a referral. Well, yeah, the kids had been involved because it was a behavior modification.
Right. So it was that sort of grant was written to help troubled teens, and that way they filtered who got into the program was through recommendations from the police department?
No, it was recommendations through several sources because it was a behavior modification program. Some of the referrals came from the juvenile courts. In order for a kid to get involved in juvenile court, he had to have been involved with police. Okay? That's one referral. Some referrals came from the school, some came from community-based agencies.
And all for troubled children.
Right. That was a grant. If we develop this as a program with certain requirements, all we have to do is sell it to them. Okay? And that's what I'm talking about. Of course, we don't want kids that's not going to cooperate because of the liability issues involved. Okay, insurance costs, okay? So, you know, it's a work in progress because it needs to be tied in where all the players, all the entities that's going to support the program can buy into it, okay? You need an area where they can wrap the motorbikes. You don't want to have to bus kids from the boundaries of Moline Township or within University Park, but really they're right if there's an area close by where they're right. It has to be a dirty area, okay? So, you know, it's a lot of coordination, a lot of planning, a lot of discussion, and agreement has to be reached. Now is the time to do it because we've got, you know, November through April to put it together. And Ms. Keller has been very responsive every time I email her, she gets right back to me.
She knows we have a very low budget, that there's only $10,000 in our, and I'm going to be using half of that for the DSU program.
I have not forgotten what Marley's told me, that I'm not getting anything. So.
Okay.
I know it, so I'm still trying to work through the... Yeah, I told Marley, she might get up with something. You know, the insurance on it, I mean, storage of bikes is only about $130 a month. You know, 10 brand new bikes. You know, these bikes are valued at $3,000 to $5,000. You know, brand new helmet will cost you about $200. You know, these are new helmets. You know, and it's tenable. So I just don't want to see this program.
Well, continue working on it, and the biggest thing is get supporters to help pay for it.
Well, see, I'm thankful I still got township boards, you know, interest, and now I've developed the interest inside the University Park Public Library. Once I can assess that, then my intention is to approach the village of the University Park Board of Trustees, you know, because there is some land in University Park that could possibly be used. You know, I probably have to talk with the school board because the school board owns that land. lot and, you know, be comfortable, you know.
I was gonna suggest, you know, we do have our township property, that's what, 2 miles or something, so, I'll do that. Now, they, and it's right behind someone else, and I think the noise would be a factor, and it would be a problem.
No, well, you know that, I was looking at that land north of the police department, you know, the parking lot, the police department land directly north of that. I don't know if it's privately owned village home, you know, that's another area I have to look at, you know, find out who owns it. And then again, I don't know how, you know, what the police department will say about it, if the trailer pulls up, you know, and kids riding motorbikes, you know, in and out of.
And you do think of the traffic of noise factor also, too.
Yeah, yeah, so I was thinking about, you know, I even thought about that land right where Moni Reservoir is, you know, but you have to get somebody to pull it, and I even thought about David, this brand new truck. I'm brainstorming all this stuff.
All right, well, let's keep doing that, okay, let's go on into the trustee audit accounts. This will be for August 22nd, 2014, to September 18th, and that should say, there's a correction on this, it says 2104, I think it means 2014. So we will change the date on that audit of accounts, please, so that it says September 18th, 2014, to 2104. Okay, and we're looking at town fund was spent $48,193.81. General assistance, $4,607.74. Terry, you want to take that one aside? Road and bridge, $14,307.80. Nothing for equipment building, nothing on the bridge account for total spent. $67,109.35 for that time period of August 22nd to September 18th, 2014. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by James. For a second?
Second.
Second by Debbie. Any further discussion? Any none? Roll call, please.
Trustee Bowler?
Yes.
Trustee Burgess?
Yes.
Trustee Young?
Yes.
All right, any board comments?
Oh, yeah. The letter that was sent out about the Illinois Department of Transportation, the Southfield County is holding the multi-module transportation improvement program. I'm going to try to do that on Monday, September 29th. Yeah, the letter that you got in the pack about the fiscal year 2016-2021 multi-module transportation center program. They're holding a meeting in the South Cook area on Monday, September 29th at the Southfield Mayor's and Manager's Office. On 3-6 that day, I'm trying to program.
And I forgot to share, these are pictures of our, we had the busing thing here where y'all was big this year on the day after Wheelwright's dedication, the day after our last. And there are pictures showing all the people that came, and so you can check that out. All right. Is there a motion to adjourn? By Debbie? Is there a roll call vote?
Trustee Bowler?
Yes.
Trustee Burgess?
Yes.
Trustee Young?
Yes.
Vice Mayor?
Yes. We are adjourned.
Yeah.
not coming again?
I'm not coming again. In fact, I don't know if she would have that.
She doesn't.
Is your kid,
blue phone?
No, I think that's a blue phone.
I'm good.
How are you doing?
Calm it down.